This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland, and I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes.
Who is the real Hillary Clinton? Clinton scholars and writers, hoping for an answer, were shocked to learn that, despite Freedom of Information Act stipulations, after 3 years, the Clinton Library has only released one half of 1% of its records.
This is the mentality of a tyranny, and yet the media treats this as if it's no big deal. It is a very, very big deal. We paid for those documents at that library. Much of our money goes into that library. It's a federally run operation.
The Clinton Library is known locally as Little Rock's Fort Knox. Nearly 2 million pages of records covering Hillary's years in the White House are locked away, clouding her role in policymaking. Over 300 Freedom of Information Act requests are pending.
Well, that's not my decision to make, and I don't believe that any president or first lady ever has, but certainly we'll move as quickly as our circumstances and the processes of the National Archives permits.
This idea they're claiming now that we're trying to release them, we're trying to as fast as we can, but the library just won't let us release them. You want the papers released, order the papers released. They're your papers.
A tendency of this administration, from the top all the way to the bottom, is to withhold information, to resist legitimate requests for information, to refuse to be forthcoming about information that is of significance and relevant.
Time and time again, you hear one thing in speeches, and then you see a campaign that has the worst kind of tactics, reminiscent of the same sort of Republican attacks on Democrats. Well, I am here to say that it is not only wrong, but it is undermining core Democratic principles.
Your opponents are saying that that's really part of a larger pattern with you, that you often avoid taking firm positions on controversial issues.
You're against same-sex marriage, now you're for it. You defended President Obama's immigration policies, now you say they're too harsh. You supported his trade deal dozens of times, you even called it the gold standard. Now, suddenly last week, you're against it. Will you say anything to get elected?
Well, actually, I have been very consistent over the course of my entire life.
All my grandparents, you know, came over here, and
turns out only one was an immigrant, three were not.
Just in July, New Hampshire, you told a crowd, you, quote, take a backseat to no one when it comes to progressive values.
I take a backseat to no one when you look at my record and standing up and fighting for progressive values.
Last month in Ohio, you said you plead guilty to, quote, being kind of moderate and center. Do you change your political identity based on who you're talking to?
No. I think that, like most people that I know, I have a range of views, but they are rooted in my values and my experience.
You know, I get accused of being kind of moderate and center. I plead guilty.
Just for the record, are you a progressive or are you a moderate?
I'm a progressive. Of course we have to deal with the problem that the banks are still too big to fail. We can never let the American taxpayer and middle-class families ever have to bail out the kind of speculative behavior that we saw. But we also have to worry about some of the other players. AIG, a big insurance company, Lehman Brothers, an investment bank. There's this whole area called shadow banking. That's where the experts tell me the next potential problem could come from.
I remember landing under sniper fire. There was supposed to be some kind of a greeting ceremony at the airport, but instead we just ran with our heads down to get into the vehicles.
Her arrival in Bosnia was not quite as dramatic as Clinton put it.
Good to see you.
Once again, her memory doesn't match our videotape. She and her daughter Chelsea lingered on the tarmac to greet U.S. military officials. Took photos. There was the group of seventh graders on the tarmac, too. And then Senator Clinton walked to the armored vehicle where she did eventually dock and enter. Memory should always match the videotape.
I have been a critic of NAFTA from the very beginning.
I think that NAFTA is proving its worth.
I stand for ending the war in Iraq, bringing our troops home.
We're going to have troops remaining there guarding our embassy. We may have a continuing training mission, and we may have a mission against Al-Qaeda in Iraq.
There's one Hillary who says, I'm going to bring the troops home right away when I'm elected president. Another Hillary who says, I'm going to keep troops in Iraq indefinitely. One of these two women is lying.
I think she did that as long as she thought that it was still politically advantageous to support the war effort. Once 2006 kicked in and the war became quite unpopular, at least for a while, then she started moving to the anti-war position, reversing her positions, which she held only months before.
Not because her heart was full of pacifistic leftist tendencies, because she thought it was the politically expedient way to go.
Time for the United States to start thinking of Iraq as a business opportunity.
I can support the president. I can support an action against Saddam Hussein because I think it's in the long-term interest of our national security.
If I had been president in 2003, I never would have started this war. And if it is still going on when I am president in 2009, I will end it.
I was one who supported giving President Bush the authority, if necessary, to use force against Saddam Hussein. I believe that that was the right vote.
If I had been president in October of 2002, I would have never asked for authority to divert our attention from Afghanistan to Iraq, and I certainly would never have started this war.
So it is with conviction that I support this resolution as being in the best interests of our nation, and it is a vote that says clearly to Saddam Hussein, this is your last chance. Disarm or be.
The best thing that could happen to us is be attacked by somebody. You know, just bring it on, because that would unify us. It would legitimize the regime.
That's the reason I say, if anybody's going to do it, we ought to do it, because we have the capability of doing it.
You know, we're not going to give anything up, and in fact, we're going to provoke an attack, because then we will be in power for as long as anyone can imagine.
Very hard to believe her, because you don't know what the next day she's going to say, and you know that it's terrible.
Everybody from a four-star general to a private understands what it means to be a leader, what it means to have moral backbone and discipline and integrity, and the military saw none of that during the 1990s and does not see that any of those attributes in Mrs. Clinton today.
Robert Buzz Patterson served as the president's senior military aide in the Clinton White House. Distinguished service in the Air Force, including combat missions, and his regular interaction with the First Lady gave him unique insight about the potential future commander-in-chief.
They see that when Mrs. Clinton says something stupid about the war, or Harry Reid says the war is lost, or Dick Durbin calls them war criminals, that is played immediately on Al Jazeera and Al Arabiya overseas. That does nothing to support the troops. All it does is embolden the enemy to believe if they can hang out a little bit longer, they win.
That's for the, you know, people investigating it to try to figure out. But we turned over everything that was work-related, every single thing.
When you speak to the public, you say, I turned over everything. That's, for the most part, a direct quote. When you talk to the public, you say, I turned over everything.
90 to 95% of my work-related emails were in the state system. If they wanted to see them, they would certainly have been able to do so.
You know what? That is maybe the 10th time you have cited that figure today.
It is.
And I have not heard anyone other than you ever cite that figure. Who told you that 90 to 95% of your emails were in the State Department system? Who told you that?
We learned that from the State Department and their analysis of the emails that were already on the system.
The Inspector General report found that less than 1% of State Department emails, record emails, were captured. So they give a number of less than 1%, and you give a number of 90%.
This pile represents the emails that you sent or received about Libya in 2011, from February through December of 2011. This pile represents the emails you sent or received from early 2012 until the day of the attack. There are 795 emails in this pile. We've counted them. There are 67 emails in this pile in 2012. And I'm troubled by what I see here.
Her defense?
They weren't marked classified. They couldn't be marked classified because by not using government servers, she actually prevented the government from reviewing her emails. It is a federal crime to negligently handle classified information under 18 U.S.C. 1924. It is a federal Class A felony under 18 U.S.C. 798. She's committed a Class A misdemeanor under 18 U.S.C. 1924.
If there's a connection between Cairo and Benghazi, she said this: there's no connection between the two. Your experts knew the truth. Your spokesperson knew the truth. Greg Hicks knew the truth. But what troubles me more is I think you knew the truth. You tell the American people one thing, you tell your family an entirely different story.
When she certified under oath, quote, under penalty of perjury to a federal judge, that she had surrendered all of her emails to the State Department. In fact, she had not.
My verdict, based on the evidence, is guilty. What's yours?
And Chief Intelligence Correspondent Catherine Herrod, she is live in Washington as we've been monitoring the State Department briefing today. Catherine, a lot of tough questions and a lot of hesitation from Mark Toner.
Well, that's right, Shannon. Really three major takeaways. One, we've got these newly released emails from Judicial Watch that relate to Clinton aide Huma Abedin. She has been the focus of a congressional investigation because she wore multiple hats when she was at the State Department, a State Department employee, also an employee for the Clinton Foundation, and then also this Clinton-aligned consulting group called Teneo. And the question is whether this has been a conflict of interest. So we got to some of that at the briefing. The
relationship with Huma Abedin that is whispered about in the dark corners of Washington. Hillary Clinton's State Department was a virtual pornographic and criminal enterprise. Besides the secretive relationship Clinton has with Anthony Weiner's wife and closet Muslim Brotherhood member Huma Abedin, there is a litany of pornographic peccadilloes and criminal acts. Diplomatic security agents sexually attacked female guards. Clinton security agents routinely solicited prostitutes. And embassy staff were caught running a drug ring in Iraq. But the most disgusting aspect of Clinton's corrupt State Department was Ambassador to Belgium Howard Gutman, who routinely ditched his security detail in Brussels and solicited prostitutes, including minors. The Inspector General investigating Gutman charged him with pedophilia, sex with children. But all of this was swept under the rug by the corruptocrat Hillary Clinton. The State Department's former chief investigator, Richard Higby, now turned whistleblower who uncovered much of Hillary Clinton's perfidy, is now suing Slick Willie's better half, and he's paying the price. It was revealed on December 30th, 2013, the same day the huge cache of NSA documents were released, that a hacker group, more than likely the NSA, stole, then deleted, an astounding 4 years worth of Richard Higby's emails. The emails included correspondence with other whistleblowers and included a treasure trove of documents revealing a State Department under Clinton that was corrupt to the core. Another State Department whistleblower, Aurelia Fednizen, didn't get her emails stolen. Instead, she received the shakedown treatment, a mob-like visit by State Department thugs who camped out in front of her house and harassed her children. But stealing emails and shakedown tactics was just one part of the attack against State Department whistleblowers. On June 29, 2013, in what is reminiscent of Nixon's plumbers, Richard Higby and Aurelia Fednizen's lawyer's office was broken into, in which documents and computers were stolen, more than likely ordered by Hillary Clinton's minions.
The second is about the Clinton Foundation and whether one could draw the conclusion that when the Crown Prince of Bahrain gives a $32 million donation to the Clinton Foundation, this really paved the way for an in-person meeting with Secretary of State Clinton. The State Department spokesman Mark Toner just said that they did not see evidence of that being the case, though one has to wonder what evidence they would need to reach that conclusion at the State Department, because unfortunately, one of the things that we have seen in our ongoing reporting is that the State Department has not been sort of a neutral arbiter of the facts always when it comes to the Clinton emails and the foundation. They've really almost become her defender in chief in many respects.
All right, Catherine Herridge reporting live on what we are seeing out of the State Department now. We are going to get reaction now with Congressman Jason Chaffetz, who is joining us now in studio, chairman of the Oversight Committee. What do you make of these new revelations in the tough time that Toner is having in trying to answer these questions about unearthed emails we haven't seen before, emails suggesting that the access to the Secretary of State was through the Clinton Foundation, and by the way, allegations that she and the Clinton Foundation are denying?
Well, he can't definitively define something because he's left in the dark. And look, when this originally started, Hillary Clinton created this system and this relationship with herself, something that the inspector general found so problematic that he referred the matter to the FBI for criminal investigation. And so he's left not being able to definitively defend her or tell the American people that the State Department assets, the assets of the United States of America, were not commingled with both the Clinton Foundation and who knows what else.
Is it a waste of time? As supporters of Mrs. Clinton say, it's a witch hunt that wastes government time and resources.
It was pretty stunning that the FBI director came before the members of the House and said that during their year-long investigation of the lies and what was going on with Hillary Clinton's emails, that they never looked at Hillary Clinton's testimony under oath. I mean, that was pretty stunning. It's public record. You raise your right hand, you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, but the FBI didn't look at that? Because clearly what she said under oath and what she did are two totally different things. To me, that's lying and misleading to Congress. The FBI gave us on Tuesday was in a secret format down in the SCIF, the Secure Communication Facility there in the House of Representatives, are the 302s, the background information, but chock full of redactions. Even I, as the chairman of the Oversight Committee, there's so much classified information there, something that's so sensitive that I can't even look at it. I don't even have the high enough security clearance. At the same time, Hillary Clinton's still telling that everybody that, you know, there were no emails that I sent, no emails that I received that contain classified information.
We have Doug Band, obviously a very close confidant of President Clinton, helped him form the Clinton Global Initiative, connected to the Clinton Foundation, sending an email to Huma Abedin saying CP, meaning Crown Prince, we believe, of Bahrain, in tomorrow to Friday, asking to see her, good friend of ours. And then we have, he asked to see HRC Thursday and Friday through normal channels. I asked, and she said she doesn't want to commit to anything. Longer that continues on there. Then Huma Abedin at some point responds and says, offering him tomorrow for a meeting with HRC, if you see, let him know. We have reached out through official channels. And apparently the story goes, when they reached out through official channels, they couldn't get to her. When they reached out through the Clinton Foundation channels, they could get to her, and that he'd made a very sizable commitment or donation.
Well, this has happened by the millions of dollars, and that begs the question, and I think it's a legitimate question. They've created this problem, the Clintons did, by having this entity, and now as James Rosen is reporting through the good work of Judicial Watch and others, that here are 150 messages left by the Clinton Foundation to the chief of staff, to Secretary Clinton. I mean, come on, it doesn't take but a third grader to add this up and say, wow, you give tens of millions of dollars through the foundation, then you get the access that you want. I think that's a legitimate question that even the State Department spokesperson, when given an opportunity, could not refute.
The core of the controversy is how truthful Mrs. Clinton has been in answering questions, sometimes under oath, about Whitewater and other matters.
She was the first lady to come under criminal investigation. In both Little Rock and Washington, D.C., she was plagued by numerous scandals.
Senator Clinton has extraordinary ability to obfuscate, refuse to answer questions, avoid confrontations, and up until now has been given a pass on it.
A story in the New York Times
talking about why Senator Clinton voted this way, because I think some people were surprised by it. And her advisor said that she voted yes because she was moving from primary mode to general election mode. Primary mode versus general election mode? How about tell the truth mode? How about we say the same thing in the primary that we say in the general election?
During the parade in which she participated, her campaign roped off reporters so they wouldn't interfere with the candidate.
Secure people don't lie. They don't lie inveterately the way she does. What drives Hillary now is power. She very much is interested in gaining power. She considers herself to be a special person. She has a lot of arrogance, a spirit of superiority about her. And this is the driving force in her life, is to gain and acquire and maintain power.
After announcing her bid for the presidency, fellow Democrats, including former Clinton confidant and Hollywood mogul David Geffen, publicly questioned Hillary's integrity and truthfulness. Such breaks within the Clinton inner circle beg the question, what is the truth about Hillary Rodham Clinton?
It's a recklessness that's born of arrogance that goes back to her 1960s roots in their narcissism. They believe they are a rule unto themselves. I mean, every time Hillary's been caught in a scandal, she really did it. No one made it up.
She's deceitful. She'll make up any story, lie about anything, as long as it serves her purpose of the moment. And the American people are going to catch on to it.
So who is the real Hillary Clinton? Is she a brilliant trailblazer poised to make history as the first female president? Or is she ruthless, cunning, dishonest, willing to do anything for power?
Yes.
One question I'd like a follow-up to. First one has to do with Susan McDougal. She said that she brought the documents of Whitewater over to you at the governor's mansion. Did you receive all the documents? And if so, what became of them?
Every document that we have obtained has been turned over to the special counsel, no matter where it came from.
Mrs. Clinton, can you tell us what you know about stories about shredding of Whitewater documents down in Arkansas?
Nothing.
At the gubernatorial mansion?
Oh, that didn't happen, and I know nothing about any other such stories.
You know nothing about documents relating to Whitewater ever shredded anywhere that you know about or authorized or didn't authorize?
Absolutely not.
When you look at all the skullduggery in the Clinton administration, all roads lead back to Hillary.
It also tells us something about the character of the American media. I mean, they carry these people. A Republican with those numbers of character flaws, with that sort of behavioral problem and psychopathic psychology, could not run or be elected to dog catcher if it were a Republican.
They in fact speak dishonestly about the integrity of their opponents, and that has been a bellwether, and it has done destruction to people who they've encountered.
Even people in the Democratic Party will acknowledge that Clintons are particularly ruthless and particularly aggressive when it comes to campaigns. They war room. This is a military metaphor for the campaign the Clintons invented regarding instant responses, that no matter what the validity of a charge, you don't explain the charge, you don't apologize for the charge, you don't admit any error, you automatically attack the integrity or the motivations of the other side.
There are any number of things in the Clintons' political history that is worth recalling before you go in to vote for, potentially, for a Clinton, in this case, a Hillary Clinton. And it's a small example, but a telling one. When they turned on the travel office, where you had career civil servants doing a great job providing the travel service for the president and his staff, and they wanted to get a lackey friend in, they could have fired the guy in charge, but they accused him of a crime. They tried to ruin his life in order to be able to get him out and get their lackeys in.
When the Clintons moved to 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue in 1993, White House veteran Billy Dale was the director of the travel office. Dale had faithfully served seven previous presidents, starting with John F. Kennedy in 1961. But Dale, who had actually voted for Clinton for president, would soon discover that business under the Clintons would not be business as usual.
We knew that we were in for a rougher transition because we had heard stories from Secret Service agents who had gone to Little Rock for a two-week stay down there. And the stories that some of the agents would come back and tell us that we just knew that it was going to be different. We didn't realize how different it was going to be. The new administration is free to fire anybody that they want to, but traditionally that does not happen.
On the day of Clinton's inauguration, Wednesday, January 20th, 1993, Billy Dale got a call from an unknown woman indicating that Catherine Cornelius, the 24-year-old third cousin of President Clinton, would soon be working in the travel office.
And I got to know who Catherine Cornelius was. She went to work in David Watkins' office answering phones, but she never let up in her demands to take over the travel office. In the meantime, I get a telephone call from a gentleman in Ohio, and he wants to know how he can get in on some of the White House charter business. And I said, that's what I do. I arrange the charters. And he said, I know, but he says, we can make some money here. If I had made arrangements with that gentleman, I speculate that things would have been very different than as they turned out.
That call was from Darnell Martins, a partner of Clinton's close friends and Hollywood producers, Harry and Linda Bloodworth Thomason, in a travel agency called TRM. When Congress investigated, they learned Harry Thomason had multiple conversations with First Lady Hillary Clinton about taking over the White House charters.
At that time, I didn't even know who Harry Thomason was, but we have since learned that Catherine was reporting to him and he was reporting to the First Lady, Hillary Clinton.
As Dale says, every new president has the right to hire new travel office staff, even though no president had done so for over 30 years. But not only was Billy Dale fired, along with six other travel office staff members, he was also locked out of his office. But that was only the beginning.
And I got accused of embezzling $14,000 that I couldn't account for because the logs were missing. At the same time, D.D. Myers is in the press room briefing the White House press corps, telling them that we were being fired for criminal misconduct and the FBI was being called in to conduct a criminal investigation.
I think that they wanted to make it look like they were doing it because there was corruption over there so nobody would criticize them, because the media liked Billy Dale and the people there.
Gary Aldrich was an FBI agent for 26 years, the last five as an agent responsible for background checks on White House staff.
Recall that the FBI had conducted investigations of all of these men and had determined that they were qualified to work in the White House and that they were honest individuals. I conducted some of those investigations. Billy Dale was humiliated and was accused of serious wrongdoing to the degree that they conduct a federal grand jury investigation and an indictment of him.
I had dedicated 32 years of my life to this job and served faithfully to Democrats and Republicans alike.
The experience was a major event in my career because it taught me that powerful politicians can misuse law enforcement authority almost whimsically. And because it was the First Lady ordering the investigation, well then charges have to be found. That scared me. That was different from my experience in the FBI of 26 years. I thought, if we have reached the level where a politician can get irritated with somebody and cause them to maybe end up in federal prison, we've got a serious problem.
When Dale's legal bills to defend himself were estimated to run as much as $750,000, he considered a plea deal, a fine of $69,000, and a brief jail sentence.
Blanche and I had been married for 38 years at that time. I decided that I would have to sell my home. Could I ask her to give up everything that we had worked for?
The plea bargain seemed just that, a bargain in order to save himself and his family from the unending ordeal. But when Dale was informed he would not be able to proclaim his innocence, he realized he couldn't bargain with the truth.
In the meantime, during this year, I got a notice from the IRS that I was being audited.
For the next 30 months, Dale was investigated. His son and daughter were also subpoenaed.
I remember Vicky, our oldest daughter, telling her mother that if I was found guilty, and maybe we better start over.
You were sent to jail for something you did.
I remember during my trial, Vicky, my oldest daughter, telling her mother that if I was found guilty and had to go to jail for something that I did not do, that she didn't know if she could live in this country any longer when the government would be responsible for doing something like that to her father.
When the case went to trial in the fall of 1995, a procession of White House journalists volunteered to serve as character witnesses for Dale, including Britt Hume and Sam Donaldson.
The press at the time, I think, ought to remind people that I testified at Billy Dale's trial as a character witness for him.
The jury needed less than 2 hours to reach a verdict.
And the jury came in and they found me not guilty on all counts. I laid my head down on the desk in front of me and cried.
Ultimately, the Office of the Independent Counsel's final report on the travel office firings found that Mrs. Clinton's sworn testimony was factually inaccurate.
Hillary Clinton was more powerful as a first lady than any first lady that had been in the White House that I knew of. That I have learned that she was involved with it more than Bill was. Bill just wiped his hands of it and just would let her handle it.
That's an example of the cynicism and the ruthlessness of the Clintons. And at the time, I think a lot of people thought that Hillary had at least as much to do with that as Bill did.
What she did to the travel office, I mean, in a way, that is the most illustrative scandal because it was such an Evita Perón act of maliciousness toward these ordinary people. This guy running the travel office all these years, I'm getting them out, getting my rich Hollywood friends in. It's not even the most illegal thing they did, but it is the most contemptible thing they did.
Billy Dale wasn't the only victim of what some would allege to be Hillary Clinton's brutal and corrupt political machine.
I finally parted company with Hillary Clinton when I saw how she was using private detectives to investigate the women who were linked to her husband. Not to change him, not to reform him, not to make him a better person, but to cow the women into silence so that he could get elected president. But he left chasing down his women and silencing them, pursuing the scandals and lying about them, escaping culpability for any of the things in their past to Hillary. She was his Nixon. She was his evil equivalent. She was the one who made sure that nothing got to him because she was so good at it. And she was.
Hillary's mastery of the black arts of attack politics is often skillfully cloaked in layers of deniability.
I do not want that woman controlling the IRS or the DEA or the NSA or the FBI or the CIA.
Hillary's got an agenda to be president of the United States. She's got a to-do list when she gets to the White House.
Her conduct as first lady, not as senator, and her lack of sensitivity to civil liberties, of privacy, using the Internal Revenue Service, her hostility to opponents, her hardness, her meanness. The Clinton administration, almost from its first day, started using the IRS as a threat.
I know a lot of tax lawyers, and they said the odds of someone like Paula Jones, with her income, being audited by the IRS is like being struck by lightning twice.
Others would claim that using the IRS to harass political enemies was a Clinton White House specialty, one reminiscent of the strong arm of Richard Nixon.
They're both very smart, very politically ruthless, very hardworking, great work habits. Some of them not complimentary, very cynical, willing to do things that are beyond the pale of proper conduct.
Proper conduct would not include using private investigators to intimidate. Those allegations come from several women involved with Bill Clinton, including Jennifer Flowers, Elizabeth Ward Grayson, Paula Jones, and Kathleen Willey.
The scare tactics, you know, being followed, being audited by the IRS, their homes broken into. I mean, where does it end?
Clinton supporter and campaign worker Kathleen Willey was a White House volunteer who alleges that President Clinton sexually assaulted her during a meeting in the private study off the Oval Office in November of 1993.
I kept thinking to myself, what in the hell is he doing? That's what I kept thinking. And which sounds silly at the time, but I was getting embarrassed for him. This is just not proper. You have to remember, this was at the time when there was a lot of speculation about his womanizing, and I was the loyal Democrat, and I would not allow myself to believe that that was true. I just thought it was all just rumor.
Willie believes that Hillary Clinton was well aware of the tactics used by the Clinton White House to intimidate perceived enemies. Willie says 2 days before she was set to testify against President Clinton in the Paula Jones sexual harassment case, a stranger confronted her.
We passed and we stopped and we said, hey, Kathleen, did you ever find your cat? And then he said, rather ominously, yeah, that bullseye was a really nice cat. And that's what I thought, that something else was going on here. He stood back and he said, you're just not getting the message, are you?
The Clinton attack machine immediately targeted Willie. However, there are corroborating witnesses. Jared Stern, a former Marine, later told congressional investigators he was hired to investigate Kathleen Willey during a clandestine nighttime meeting.
It was late at night. He called me, asked me to meet him here in this parking garage. I met him, said he had something very important to discuss. I talked to him about it, discussed the tasking, and then I left to carry it out.
Stern declines to discuss what he was hired to do. But Stern has admitted he was so uneasy about it that he called Willie, using an alias.
I made a telephone call to Miss Willie. I left a message on her answering service indicating that I'd try again the next day.
And he left a message for me saying, be careful, that there were people out to get me. Jared Stern is a firsthand witness to what the Clintons are doing, have done, and are doing to these women.
The Clintons are a unit. They share a zeal for power and a willingness to engage in any and all threat-neutralizing strategies. Legality be damned. No one will ever say what happened to Kathleen Willey was an anomaly. That MO can be seen throughout the Clintons' political lives. It is consistent.
Willey says her car was vandalized, her house broken into, and a cat's skull was left on her porch. Today, she still lives in fear.
But as Maya Angelou once said, when someone shows you who they are, believe them the first time.
I don't understand how any woman in this country could vote for a woman who does that to other people, who sets out to destroy and ruin these women who have crossed paths with Bill Clinton. They're power hungry. They stop at nothing. They stop at nothing.
If you put me to work for you, I'll work to lift people up, not push them down.
We all had a good laugh when Hillary Clinton first tweeted out that all survivors of sexual assault deserve to be believed. After all, it's completely ironic considering there was countless women who accused her husband Bill of sexual assault, and they were completely vilified not only by this sycophantic Clinton media, but by Hillary Clinton herself. But there was one person in particular who wasn't laughing at all, Kathy Shelton. Now, at 12 years old, Kathy was raped and beaten so viciously that she was put into a coma for 5 days, only to wake up to the doctors telling her that she would probably 99% chance never be able to have children. And in 1975, Hillary Clinton defended Kathy Shelton's attacker, Thomas Alfred Taylor, even though she knew he was guilty. Hillary Clinton herself personally and coldly interrogated sixth grader Kathy Shelton. She blamed the rape on her. She used insane tactics that would be illegal today under rape shield laws. Taylor was able to get off, which is a few months in jail time for raping and nearly murdering a 12-year-old girl. So not only with this case do we get a huge reveal into, you know, what kind of a champion for women and children Hillary Clinton really is, we're beginning to see just where Hillary Clinton started to learn how to manipulate the law in her favor. I'm joined now by Kathy Shelton and her attorney, Candace Jackson. Also, you're the author, and you guys have the website, theirlivesfoundation.net, reaching out to a lot of people about this topic. And we really thank you for coming here today to share your story with us. And I know this is really difficult for you having to relive this, but if you could please just sort of describe what happened that day.
I was going to church with some friends. I was going to ride my bicycle there. It's a couple blocks away. And my mother didn't really want me to, but I talked her into it. But she was going to pick me up that night in the car, and which we've done before, and, you know, throw the bike in the back. And on the way, riding to the people's house, two men got out of a truck and approached me and scared me and said I was going with them. I tried to get away, but I couldn't. They forced me in the truck and I was screaming and crying, and it was like no one could hear me. And we went to some road out. I'm not sure the name of the road. All I know is there's a lot of fields. I remember seeing a lot of fields and stuff, and they're ripping my clothes off and beating me. And out there they raped me, and I was left out of the truck on the ground and unconscious at one time. I came to consciousness, or I may be saying that wrong, but I crawled to a porch out of nowhere because I didn't see no houses. How I got to the porch, I never know. I think the man up above may have something to do with it, but I knocked on the door and the porch light came on. They were coming back to finish killing me. I think they already thought I was dead. And when the porch light came on, it scared them, and she got their tag number, and that's how they got them and arrested them today. Today, that's how they got them. Mm. I woke up 5 days later in a hospital with a coma, out of a coma, and was told that I could never, it was a 99% chance that I could never have children again, and had several stitches in my private parts.
Just so incredible. And then, so it didn't really end for you there, because this was such a vicious attack, almost a murder. It something had to be done about it, and you were brave enough to speak up, maybe trying to pursue pressing charges. And at that time, here comes this woman, Hillary Rodham, who is now basically putting you on trial and making you present the case of you know, blaming you for what happened to you. Tell us what that was like for you to be interrogated and victimized again.
It was like being dramatized again, not only the rape, but it was like just being re-dramatized, and it got so bad that she put me through so much hell that I asked my mother to take me away from it. I couldn't take it no more. Never take me back there. I don't care what happens. And I prayed to God after that that I forget his face and never see him again.
There's just no words, I think, that can describe what impact this has on a 12-year-old who's not only violated this way, but then made to feel at such a young age like it's her fault, like she's the one lying about what happened, being told by the female defense attorney, not but being coldly interrogated by this woman who then pushes this girl into a lie detector test and accuses her of lying and faking and making things up, talking about her like she's scum in the sense of saying you're on the wrong side of the tracks, asking the court to order a psychiatric exam because she's prone to making things up and exaggerating because she comes from what Hillary called a disorganized family. Single mom. Mom's a single mother. That's what Hillary Clinton went on the attack with, to say, therefore, she can't be telling the truth. Therefore, she seeks out older men and fantasizes and romanticizes sexual experiences like that. Things that had no foundation in fact or reality at all. And these were things that Hillary Clinton chose to throw at this young victim. It's classic blame the victim tactics that would be outlawed under all the rape shield laws state by state today.
Hillary Clinton, she was able to just kind of quiet it down and say, well, I had an obligation to represent my client and I was forced to take this case. Is that a fact or?
We have worked very hard through Their Lives Foundation this year to dig into the case because so far the mainstream media has been willing to take at face value Hillary Clinton's own denials, explanations. We have been able to begin to uncover hard evidence between court documentation and witnesses that have never been spoken to before, begin to confirm what really went on. And almost every single piece of the story that Hillary Clinton has chosen to put forward in her autobiography, in audio taped interviews she's done about this case, turns out to be flat out lies, starting with the fact that she was never required to take this case. This was a voluntary decision on her part. She herself tells inconsistent stories. She at one point says the prosecutor called her and asked her to take it as a favor to him. Okay. In another place, she chooses to say that the prosecutor said, I've asked the judge to appoint you to this case. So her own story is inconsistent. But whichever explanation, even if it were true, neither means that she was mandated or required to accept this case. She could have said no. She could have said, a 12-year-old victim raped that brutally, almost killed? Boy, I'm a rape culture advocate. I can't do that. She absolutely could have said that. No, she wanted the case. Hillary Clinton used this case as an opportunity to aggrandize herself, win at all costs, and put into play some of her liberal philosophies.
Right, because she actually did argue for the work release, and he was able to leave during the day, go to work, just a 5-minute walk from your home, from Kathy's home, and then go back to prison at night.
Who knows who he knew that she knew, and it was fear.
The fact is Hillary Clinton argued for that, and knowing where his work was, 5 minutes away from the victim's home, you know, as a woman who claims to be this longtime champion advocate for women and children, it's just unheard of that she would fight so voraciously to get this man basically every kind of plea that she could, lighten the deal for him in whatever ways. Of course, there's some instances, seems like tampering with evidence.
Hillary Clinton's disregard for proper protocol in this case with respect to handling the evidence, we have only recently been able to verify, it is astounding. She claimed in her audio taped interviews back in the 80s that she got special court order to take the physical evidence with her to New York to show it to her own blood expert, and that his testimony was what she used to persuade the prosecutor and the judge to give this guy a plea bargain. What we have found out is we've identified who that scientist was that she went to visit in New York. We've confirmed that there's nothing in the court records that indicates any kind of a special order that would permit a defense attorney to personally just grab up physical evidence like this. In this case, it happened to be a pair of the defendant's underwear. Well, she just stuffs it in her bag, stuffs it in her purse, and takes it with her out of state. The judge issued an order in this case that said specifically, the defense can't do anything to independently test the evidence that would interrupt the prosecution's chain of custody. Can't think of anything more dramatic interrupting the chain of custody than the defense attorney putting herself in the position of actually becoming a chain of custody witness in the case by personally, physically taking charge of the underwear like that, taking it all around with her on a weeks-long trip that she talks about, and then ending up in New York and finding this supposed scientist and, you know, coming into his basement, pulling out the underwear she talks about and letting him do a visual inspection, and then coming back and using that with no written report from this expert, no scientific backup for what she says was not sufficient evidence on the underwear, but simply telling the judge and the prosecutor, oh, this guy is going to come out from New York to prevent a miscarriage of justice unless you let my guy off. And the judge and prosecutor rolled over with that and accepted it and let this violent predator out on a lesser charge, plead to a lesser charge, and serve no further time in jail.
Right. Once again, here she is on the wrong side of history, choosing the side of a rapist in this case. And then, of course, all the years that she defended her husband and attacked his victims. So this is kind of a set the precedent for we're seeing just patterns here. In this case, she took this case on as a favor. As I think you've pointed out, they were donors to Bill Clinton's campaign. The judge and...
That's right. The judge and, it turns out, his son. The judge was an early, on-the-record, hardcore supporter of a young Bill Clinton running his first congressional campaign. And the judge encouraged his son, then a law school student, to also be a Bill Clinton donor and supporter. And that's on record as having been the case. It is puzzling, at the least, to me that we have uncovered and proved the fact that in this case, the judge's son, who was barely graduated from law school, was not a licensed attorney, is the person whose signature signed off on a court order granting Hillary a preliminary hearing when the same request had been denied to the public defender who was defending this rapist before Hillary took the case. Mm. What is the judge's son, not even an attorney, doing signing off on court orders? I think the implications are clear. Hillary had some inside help to start rigging the system and manipulating the evidence from the very beginning to put in a win for herself.
Right. And it just shows that it doesn't matter what the ethical standards are there. She's willing to go past them, bend them, attack the victims, if it means that she can support her big time donors. Kathy, what did you think about that when she first came out putting out this message to sexual assault survivors? You all deserve to be believed. We're with you. What did you, I mean, by this time you learned that it was Hillary Clinton that was the woman interrogating you in that room so long ago. What did you think when she spoke those words?
I think if we deserve to be believed, why didn't she believe me at 12 years old instead of coming out of law school and putting me through what no 12-year-old should be put through? A lie detector test, first of all, I've been told many times if you move in that, it shows you lie, but it showed I lied because Candace, help me out here. I can't say this right.
It's difficult. It's really difficult because, you know, again, a sixth grader had never had sex before, and Hillary Clinton used the results of a polygraph that she made Kathy Shelton take to accuse Kathy of lying based on a question asked in that polygraph about whether or not full penetration had occurred. And because Kathy was confused about that question, that was used against Kathy to say, ah, she's lying.
Mm. And
in that case where I represented that guy, it was a fascinating case. It was a really interesting case. This guy was accused of raping a 12-year-old. He was the daughter of a family he was living in Springfield. He lived on the side of the tracks in Springfield. And the guy was from Green Forest. His family still had a little farm. And he was one of these ruthless folks who wasn't going to make a living on the land. And he was kind of around. Ended up in Springfield looking. Of course, he claimed that he did all this stuff. He took a lie detector test. I had to take a polygraph, which he passed, which forever destroyed my faith in polygraphs.
And the fact that there's a preponderance of evidence, including the fact that she had to have stitches in certain parts and that the doctors told her 99% chance she would never be able to have children. And then to use that, you know, you're asking a child to describe sexual terms they'd never encountered before. I mean, what kind of a dark heart must a person have to be able to treat you like that? I mean, that to me is just what's so shocking. I can't imagine as a 12-year-old girl, were you just kind of wondering, like, why is this woman treating me like that?
Yeah, and then also, you know, all the evidence, like hospital records, the police report, supposedly been lost in some flood. Any evidence that we try to go get, it seems it's all been lost. So I feel like she's done the same thing that she's doing with these emails and everything. She's gotten rid of it.
Right.
She knew what she was doing. She got rid of it.
Points the finger of blame at everyone else. I had to do it. You know, it's no remorse. No remorse.
The first time I ever met Donald Trump, he gave me a hug and he said, "I'm so sorry for what you've had to go through." You know, Hillary has never said nothing to me in any way of any remorse. It's always laughing at me like it's funny in every book or film or anything she's wrote about me.
Hillary Clinton's Machiavellian behavior, her tendency to manipulate, deceive, and destroy for personal gain, is nothing new. This woman, now a hero to feminists, gained much of her power during the Clinton presidency from her ability to deal with her husband's infidelities.
The entire U.S. presidential election is nearing an explosive crisis over a secretly made Israeli intelligence video recording showing former President Bill Clinton raping a 13-year-old girl that Hillary Clinton has kept hidden from public knowledge with help from the American propaganda mainstream media. Jeffrey Epstein, and who is now being called the billionaire pedophile who could bring down Hillary Clinton, the clothing shop network, was originated in the early 1980s by one of the most secretive billionaires in America named Leslie Wexner, and whose father, Harry Wexner, changed from Hagen Wexelstein, emigrated to the United States in the late 1930s from the Jewish Autonomous Oblast, former Soviet Union. The clothing shop network name itself was derived from Leslie Wexner being one of America's top clothers and who owns the U.S.-based fashion retailers L Brands and Victoria's Secret. In 1982, Wexner recruited Jeffrey Epstein into the clothing shop network by providing him with an estimated $1 billion to establish a private financial firm named J. Epstein & Company. And the true purpose of J. Epstein & Company was to allow Jeffrey Epstein to operate within the society circles of America's political elites, and once ensnaring his victims, he allowed them to fulfill their most deviant sexual fantasies, while at the same time secretly video recording them for the purpose of blackmail. Former President Bill Clinton, who was revealed by recently released flight logs revealed to have flown on Epstein's private jet named the Lolita Express to the secluded, sex toyland, Caribbean island run by Epstein 26 times, while ditching his Secret Service protectors, and his failing to notice that this end of sin was wired with hidden cameras secretly recording his orgies with underage girls, with Bill Clinton's having had sex with young girls, and Hillary Clinton being advised by the clothing shop network that they had the secretly recorded videos proving it. She then masterminded a plot to set up Donald Trump as a straw man to be her opponent, and as emails prove, and was aided in this effort by America's mainstream media, who provided gave to the New York City billionaire builder an estimated $3 billion in free media advertising, so that he could become the Republican Party candidate for president. The Hillary Clinton email proving this plot shows her and her accomplices conspiring to set up Donald Trump as their Pied Piper candidate, with some of them suggesting that Senator Ted Cruz or Dr. Ben Carson could, likewise, be set up too. To why Hillary Clinton and her accomplices selected Donald Trump to be their straw man Pied Piper was due to his knowing Jeffrey Epstein too, but who, unlike Bill Clinton, Prince Andrew, and others who engaged in sex with young girls on Orgy Island, never committed these grave crimes. And as attested by Miami Police Detective Mike Fiston, who investigated Epstein's many crimes and stated that in hundreds of interviews with hundreds of witnesses, no one has ever identified Trump as being involved in any kind of sexual activity with underage girls. In fact, Detective Fiston recalls learning in the early 2000s that members of Trump's private Palm Beach club, Mar-a-Lago, complained that Epstein was often accompanied by very young girls, a different girl every week, each of whom he would refer to as his niece, with Hillary Clinton and her accomplices believing they had neutralized Donald Trump by his merely knowing Epstein. However, and their further belief that the avalanche of scandals surrounding Trump would cause his campaign to collapse upon itself, this New York City billionaire, instead, has defied all normal logic and is nearing winning the U.S. presidency, in a last chance bid to destroy Donald Trump. Hillary Clinton and her accomplices have now paid off a number of Bill Clinton's rape victims to change their story, saying that Trump had raped them, the details of which are contained in a U.S. federal court filing making these absurd allegations, with Hillary Clinton having already proven she will kill to protect the public from knowing of her husband's crimes against young girls, and from the next event in this most dangerous of games will be determined by Clothing Shop Network, and if the past is a predictor of the future knowing how the Israelis work to keep their nation safe, someone will surely die before this plays itself out. We are Anonymous.
Understand that the NYPD is saying yes, pedophilia, the pedophile island, Jeffrey Epstein, all of it. And they always knew this was going to come out in the last 6 months. So that's why, because this NYPD thing started almost a year ago. That's why they tried to claim Trump was with Epstein and all this stuff with no proof and then drop the lawsuits, was to know, oh God, if it comes out, we got to have him blamed too, because we know that's what we've done. So the big issue here is law enforcement is begging you, not that they're perfect, nobody's perfect, but they're the ones blowing the whistle. They're the ones that keep arresting high-level Homeland Security people locally who are involved in pedophilia. You see it in the news all the time, because this is a guild that got control of Penn State. They got control of the Catholic Church to a great extent to take it over. They've gotten control of the royal family. They admit it's a national security issue in the UK, pedophilia, Satanism, kids being killed. This is mainstream news. So it's all coming out. In her college thesis, she was a pen pal with Saul Alinsky, who wrote Rules for Radicals, who was an admitted communist and basically one of the ideological leaders of the Weathermen, who, of course, were also advisors to Obama. Advisors to Obama. Advisors to Obama. And he pledged his book to Lucifer. And he talked about deceiving the public, overthrowing America, going after Christians, creating basically a hell on earth. And there was sweet little Hillary being groomed all along and pen pals with him and writing her thesis on how wonderful Saul Alinsky was.
Once a month, Hillary would go out to Los Angeles. And she did it so regular that it became a bit of an issue trying to, why is she always going? Bill told me that she was going out there, she and a group of women, and she would be a part of a witch's church. And when Bill told me that, you could have hit me with a baseball bat. I tried to point out to him, he realized what had happened if that got out. Of course, my job is to make sure it didn't get out. Now, I don't know today if Hillary still partakes in the witch ritual. I don't know that I even know what the ritual was. But for the better part of many years, Hillary would go quite often, whether it was regularly once a month or maybe once every couple of months. She would go out on a weekend simply to be a part of it.
Let's get all this out in the open, ladies and gentlemen. Let's talk about it. Let's talk about the Secret Service and FBI. Grown men breaking down and crying. And being forced, as corrupt as they've been and the problems that have been there in the government, to finally tell the truth. We had on a law enforcement source from New York 2 days before saying, no, I'm being told there's code words in the emails for the trafficking of children. And the FBI's on record saying Wiener, who's involved in all this, is contacting 15-year-olds and that they, quote, reopened it as a sex investigation. Now the FBI comes out today and admits they believe Hillary Clinton traveled to the orgy island of Jeffrey Epstein, who admittedly was trafficking in small children on his wide-body jet around the world. And Bill Clinton traveled on it 20-plus times, Hillary 6 times.
Never send a boy to do a woman's job.
Thing is Hillary Middleman, Rado. Last name is Clinton, the lyrics I got him.
He said that I respect your children, but that wasn't quite right, yo.
I'm only 12 years old.
That's enough.
Shit.
But gotta get pushy.
That's your daughter.
Well, grab her by the pussy.
I mean, this is an epic time to be alive. And by the way, the background research is now happening on the internet as we learn about the rituals. We pulled up a Washington Post article with Podesta's brother and blood ritual photos and naked kids in the Washington Post. 8-9 days ago, the FBI reopened the investigation because of what they said they found on a laptop that had not been given over to the FBI. This was in an NYPD investigation. We didn't learn that for about 4 or 5 days. I learned about it actually first when I was told about it by Doug Agman. A day later, it was in the news that the NYPD was going to have a press conference 2 weeks ago bringing out the fact that in a separate case with a girl who complained, who was 15, sexted by Wiener, they'd gotten his laptop and it was full of child trafficking, money laundering, blackmail, you name it. Anthony Wiener. I mean, look at Abney, look at Wiener. My God, her mother's the top genital mutilation of little girls in the world, the main pusher of cutting girls' genitals off. Talk about sex abuse. These people are demons obsessed with children. We already know that in their public life. So that's why the FBI was forced to do this. Now, the rank-and-file FBI wants to expose as well. That's all come out in the London Guardian, New York Times, that they're in total revolt, saying Hillary is pure evil, a devil. Notice I told you months ago, I was told that by federal sources, that we literally think she's a devil. I go, what do you mean? And they said, Linda Blair. I said, what do you mean? Linda Blair. I've talked to Blackwater people, you name it. She is literally like Linda Blair, okay? Our federal sources say they're devil worshipers. Our federal sources say they're really doing horrible things. And I didn't even say on air some of the stuff I was told, but quite frankly, they just said, it's worse than what you're saying. It's and I said, well, like what? And they said, devil worship. I said, well, they said, devil worship, Alex, okay? Imagine feds telling you, no one will believe us. They told the London Guardian, she's literally the Antichrist. That's the headline. These people are scared, folks. Whatever it is they've been seeing, and they won't even tell me, they say you'll be walking down the hall at night, and it's Obama. He acts totally normal, and it'll be like crap your pants, okay? I don't know what's going on, folks. All I know is it's all coming out. They do these rituals, these kids. They're hooked in people that are got kids disappearing from Haiti. The Clintons are vacationing in Haiti. They had their honeymoon there. They admit they're into voodoo. I got Washington Post saying they follow voodoo. I'm going to show it all to you. And again, that's a Zero Hedge article. But people go, oh, that's Zero Hedge. Well, they're respected. It's The Guardian. See, second line right there. Click. Second line, The Guardian. This is senior FBI agents say they're all against her. They say she's the Antichrist. They're scared. What did I tell you 2 months ago? They're all against her. They're scared. And they say, why? And they just go, Antichrist, Antichrist. I have talked to feds, folks, that start getting tears in their eyes because they've signed letters. They can't say what it is. That when they talk about it, they start breaking down, okay? Grown men start breaking down. Do you understand? And she's falling down all the time. And she's got a special van. And it's getting worse. And she goes crazy all the time. And like Linda Blair. And she stinks. And so does Obama. And I go, what do you mean? They're like, no one wants to work around him. I want candy. Spirit cooking. Clinton campaign chairman invited to bizarre satanic performance, which they admit he attended. I want candy. I want candy. Where they drink semen, blood, urine, and more. I want candy. I want candy. And then pour blood on effigies of small babies. And worship Baphomet. And they admit this is from Aleister Crowley in their own admissions. And that's just what they publicly are up to. The New York Times did a review of it, strangely enough, November 1st, about how wonderful this lady is, who is a priestess of Aleister Crowley. Reportedly the most wicked man to ever live. Oh, you're crazy. You just don't get performance art. The woman admits she does real rituals. She admits she's a high priestess. When it's in public, she says, well, the intent's different. Yeah, it's to suck folks into the cult. When it's in private, she says, yeah, we're doing rituals. Do you understand? And this hidden white magic we're talking about here, folks, this is the nasty stuff, okay?
Tom Horn, in his book, Apollyon Rising 2012, stated, quote, behind the scenes and beyond view of the world's uninitiated members, the alchemy and rituals of the occult masters, Illuminists, Masons, Bonesmans, Bilderbergers, and Bohemians have combined to harmonize so completely within recent U.S. foreign and domestic policies as to clearly point to a terrifying civil conjecture, a near future horizon upon which a leader of indescribable brutality will appear. Although this false prince of peace will seem at first to hold unique answers to life's most challenging questions, ultimately he will make the combined depravities of Antiochus Epiphanes, Hitler, Stalin, and Genghis Khan look like child's play.
That is why I am running for president of the United States.
Antichrist. Bible says there's many antichrists, folks, but she's a walker. I mean, she's full possessed. And that demon lets out of there, she hits the ground. That woman's a frickin' hellhound. An actual full-bore, bipedal, conscious, walking demon. And that's the FBI. They've been around her. Secret Service, the people have nightmares. They crap their pants. They want off the detail. I don't know whether it's some super mental illness or whether interdimensional crap's real or whatever. The point is, people that have been around her start crying. Now, let's get into the headlines here. Let me just show everybody thinks this is a big joke. Places like Salon, when you're not writing articles about how great pedophilia is and some sicko, how he desires five-year-old girls. I mean, they got some freaky stuff. This is who these people are. What's happened at the Catholic Church and what's going on with Sandusky? I think it's funny. This is WorldNet Daily. Source, FBI has evidence Hillary visited Orgy Island. That's today. Here's the Washington Post. The time Bill and Hillary Clinton went to a voodoo ceremony in Haiti. I'm going to actually get to where he says they got married there. They had their honeymoon there. They got honeymoon there, not married. And how he loves to have the spirits, good and evil, enter him. And how and that's his world religion. By the way, if you voodoo, sacrifice children. Eric Prince, NYPD, ready to make arrests in Anthony Weiner case. Hillary flying to the pedophile island. High-level federal and state law enforcement and city law enforcement sources. Trafficking of children. And, I mean, you look at Weiner, you look at Aberdeen, my God. The word is, Weiner isn't even, Weiner's like a Renfield for Dracula. He just kind of stumbles around all day. And, again, a lot of people that work for these people were abused themselves. FBI agents, Hillary is the Antichrist personified. Mention that. That's out of The Hill, and that's out of The Guardian. And they keep asking, they go, what do you mean Antichrist? You mean figure? They go, no, Antichrist. They go, what? They go, she's evil. Okay, let's continue. Never heard the FBI talk like that before, have you? Because this stuff's real, folks. This stuff happens. This is the takeover of the United States, okay? Julian Assange, and I've got clips of him doing a new interview today coming up. America Press supports demon Hillary Clinton. And Bill calls her a demon. He wants to, quote, put our necks all in a noose if she gets in. Okay? Here's another one. This is the Washington Post I mentioned from 1996. Book says Hillary talks to the dead. It says that it calms her, but that she'll talk to anybody but Jesus Christ. Of course, it's a demon. And then it goes through how she does it. And we have an article breaking it down, flashback, occultic Hillary summons the dead, refuses to speak to Christ. Hillary was attending a satanic church, says Clinton insider. Now here's Bill Clinton's book, page 312, 313, and 314. Show this to TV viewers. This is the book, My Life, The Early Years. He goes into, I was particularly intrigued by voodoo and culture, to which I had some limited exposure in New Orleans and existed alongside Catholicism in Haiti. So they went and they got their honeymoon there, and then he talks about practicing chemical engineer until his voodoo priest grandfather in his deathbed chose Max to succeed him. He explains that in voodoo, God is manifest to humans, whose spirits represent forces of light and darkness, good and evil, which are more or less in balance. After Hillary, Dave and I finished our brief course in voodoo, theology, we were escorted back to an open area and seated. And he goes through voodoo rituals he conducts and how he enjoyed the spirits.
And so what is behind it is a spiritual agenda, as it says in Ephesians 6:12. But it's also something that experientially that you can see in the research of the New World Order, that they are attending rituals, they are receiving instruction from those rituals, and that instruction is to do the nuts and bolts things, to create the system, to do this, to do the poisoning or whatever, all the different conspiracies that are a part of that, have some sort of mechanism or use in this future world government, world religion, world economy, which has one purpose, isn't to extract the worship of humanity for an ancient cherub. Connection to Satanism is really what started to pique my interest early on, and that they were theistic, you know, Satanists. They really did believe that Satan was God, and they actively worshipped him and received instructions from the spirit world. That was what tripped me out, and to see that network and every door that was kicked down, you know, investigation led to somewhere some Satanistic connection. So the answer to what the ultimate goal and the question of who or what do I believe is behind it is the same. That is the Antichrist.
Character is defined as what we do when we think no one is looking. By that standard, many critics say the Clintons are sorely lacking.
People want to know Hillary. The Hillary that I knew back here in Arkansas. When she was in the Benghazi hearings, when she said, "What difference does it make? They're dead."
What difference at this point does it make?
That's the Hillary I know.
We came, we saw, he died.
One thing about Hillary, it was just a good timing guy. But Hillary, she's an animal. Hillary is the one that I promise you, she pulls the string. She pulled him in Arkansas. She pulled him in the White House when she was there as a first lady. And my God, if she gets to be president.
She launched wars against the Serbs to bring in jihad armies out of Albania. She bombed TV stations with depleted uranium and bragged that she's the one that got Clinton to go ahead and pull the trigger. She supported the most incredible sanctions, basically doubling what George Herbert Walker Bush had done, even stopping shipments of food into Iraq. And over a 500,000 children died. But her own Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright, her confidant, her mentor, told 60 Minutes that it was a good price to pay a 500,000 dead kids.
We have heard that 500,000 children have died. I mean, that's more children than died in Hiroshima. You know, is the price worth it?
I think this is a very hard choice, but we think the price is worth it.
She got thrown off of the Watergate investigative committee because she was caught fabricating evidence against Richard Nixon. I mean, this girl was involved in the dirtiest of the dirt from the moment she got out of the gate. There were over 100 murders, now known as Arkanside, where enemies of the Clintons were killed. But don't worry, the Arkansas medical examiner, Fami Malek, said it's totally normal to chop your arms, your legs, and your head off in a suicide.
Amidst cries of being hacked by the Russian government, the Clinton campaign has been hit by FBI investigations, the resignation of DNC chairperson Debbie Wasserman Schultz, and calls for the imprisonment of Hillary Clinton herself. This all due to the WikiLeaks of thousands of personal emails from Clinton's account, separate to the one she should have been using on U.S. State Department servers.
It was around 4 a.m. on a Sunday.
4 a.m. on a Sunday.
27-year-old Seth Rich was in this very neighborhood, telling his girlfriend over the phone he'd be home soon. He was about a block away when he was stopped in his tracks, right here at Flagler Place. Police patrolling the area heard gunshots and later found Rich conscious but shot multiple times, including at least once in the back. He later died at the hospital. 18 days later, police tell me there are still no witnesses, no suspects, and no motive.
In the American political lexicon, there's such a thing as the October surprise. The stuff that you're sitting on, is an October surprise in there? What you're sitting on?
WikiLeaks never sits on material. Our whistleblowers go to significant efforts to get us material and often very significant risks. As a 27-year-old who works for the DNC, who was shot in the back, murdered just 2 weeks ago, for unknown reasons as he was walking down the street in Washington. So
that was just a robbery, I believe, wasn't it?
No, there's no finding. So
What are you suggesting?
I'm suggesting that our sources take risks, and they become concerned to see things occurring like that.
But was he one of your sources then? I mean,
we don't comment on who our sources are.
But why make the suggestion about a young guy being shot in the streets of Washington?
Now, if I try to chronicle all the crimes committed by the Clintons when they were in the White House for 8 years, we'll be here for 10 hours. So let me just skip past all the stuff that happened and Monica Lewinsky and the Chinese generals in the White House and our missile secrets being transferred to the communist Chinese and national sovereignty being sold out and our jobs being sold out with NAFTA and GATT and how the Clintons engineered getting rid of the Glass-Steagall Act to allow big mega banks to create all this counterfeit money and derivatives. Let's just forget about all that. Let's fast forward to what they've been doing in the last decade. Launching their big giant foundation, and we have the emails, where she sold access to the Chinese president, where she sold access through the State Department to change U.S. policy if donors would give her money.
Phone calls to whom I have it in.
On January 20th, 2001, President Clinton issued 140 pardons on his last day in office. Those pardoned or receiving commuted sentences included cocaine trafficker Carlos Vignali and the biggest tax fugitive in U.S. history, Mark Rich. As much as those pardons reveal about Bill, an earlier pardon may have revealed even more about Hillary's character and her willingness to do anything to get elected.
On January 24th, 1975, I was working a surveillance on the west side of Manhattan, and the sirens started to go off. Just an endless stream of fire trucks, police vehicles going down to the southern end of Manhattan. A short time later, turning on a radio, easy to find out that there had been a bombing at Francis Tavern.
The senseless bombing had been perpetrated by what was arguably the most active terrorist organization in U.S. history, the FALN.
So, in September 1999, right in the middle of her Senate campaign, she was approached by City Councilman Jose Rivera, who really is a spokesman for the Hispanic community in New York, who gave her a packet urging the pardoning of the FALN terrorists. And included in the packet was a letter to Hillary asking her to use her influence on her husband to get these pardons granted. And 2 days later, they were.
Freedom came today for most of the 14 Puerto Ricans who accepted President Clinton's controversial gift of clemency. 11 of them, who describe themselves as nationalists, some others describe them as terrorists, were released from federal prisons around the country.
Prior to that action, the Clinton administration had granted clemency in just 3 cases out of over 3,000 applications, according to the Office of the Pardon Attorney at the Justice Department.
Sandy Berger appeared on television a day or two after the pardons were granted, or after the clemency was granted, and stated that these people were not personally involved in violence. That's simply not the fact. In this case, these people were convicted of planting 36 bombs in Chicago. If that's nonviolence, then Mr. Berger's dictionary is a little bit different than mine is. Department of Justice received a memo from the FBI saying that under no circumstances should these people be released. The President of the United States, who had access to all this information, ignored the facts of the matter. You have to ask yourself, who benefited from this besides the terrorists themselves? It's my view that I've concluded the only other person that could have benefited from this was Hillary Clinton.
Candidate Clinton claims she is the most experienced. Her husband claimed she was intimately involved in his administration. And yet, Hillary said publicly she had, quote, no involvement in or prior knowledge of the decision.
That she sent people dressed as Bernie Sanders supporters to attack Trump rallies so she could blame both Trump and Sanders. Then she stole the nomination. And even CNN and the Associated Press admitted that it was the super PACs. It was the big donors. It was the super delegates who actually decided who would be the nominee.
Buzz Patterson carried the nuclear football for President Clinton. While serving in the Clinton White House, he learned firsthand about the former First Lady's qualifications.
When she was moving them around the White House hallways and corridors, the edict was for us to avoid eye contact with her so as to preclude her from making exchanges like good morning, good afternoon, and therefore those of us that worked in and around herself and her husband would oftentimes dive into open office ways or doorways to avoid her stare. Well, I saw her vent on her husband many, many times. In one particular situation, we were at a fundraiser. As we entered the elevator to go to the top floor of this hotel, Mrs. Clinton lit into her husband with every profane four-letter word you've ever heard in your life, and as a military guy, I've heard them all. Anger really took me by surprise, how vicious it was and how profane it was. And then, of course, we got to the top floor of the elevator, of the hotel, and the elevator opened. They were holding hands and smiling and waving like they could turn it on and off in a heartbeat.
So you say again, okay, well, she's flipping, she's flopping. No, she's not flipping and flopping. She is lying. She will not take responsibility for calling and asking our good, brave soldiers to put their life on the line. She will not take responsibility.
The war on terror isn't the only issue where Hillary is trying to have it both ways. When it's politically expedient, Hillary campaigns on her husband's presidency. But when the polls say otherwise, she abandons their record.
But she can't be as selective in terms of, you know, cherry picking and making determinations that she's now suddenly the face of foreign policy, that she, you know, shaped economic policy, except for the stuff that didn't work out, in which case that was somebody else's problem or somebody else's.
Both have been quick to fault the Bush administration for failing to prevent the 9/11 attacks, while absolving the Clinton White House of any missed opportunities.
There were many times, 8 to 10 that I'm aware of, in the 1990s, that we had a chance as a country to capture bin Laden or to kill him, 8 to 10. And every time we had a viable opportunity, Clinton chose not to pull the trigger.
You know, and I'm certain that if my husband and his national security team had been shown a classified report entitled Bin Laden Determined to Attack Inside the United States, he would have taken it more seriously than history suggests it was taken by our current president and his national security team.
He says President Clinton was briefed by multiple U.S. intelligence agencies of al-Qaeda plans to attack the United States.
We knew about the potential, for specifically pointed to the possibility of using hijacked airliners into the Pentagon, CIA headquarters, and it also talked about New York City.
Cyrus Narasta is the award-winning writer-producer of the ABC miniseries The Path to 9/11. Though his movie takes aim at both the Clinton and Bush administrations in the days and years prior to 9/11, Narasta says he and his film were targeted by the Clinton machine.
There was a huge coordinated campaign to discredit the movie and me and get Disney ABC to pull or recut the movie.
In the weeks just prior to air, Narasta's home address and email were posted on various pro-Clinton websites.
I got death threats at my house. I got hate mail. And they set about basically trying to destroy us and stop this thing from airing. Intimidation included 5 senators, led by Harry Reid, sending a letter to Disney ABC threatening to revoke their station licenses if they didn't pull or recut the movie. You gotta understand, these phone calls, the threats on the internet, these bloggers, all of these people out there, none of them had seen the movie.
It's shocking that ABC would bow down to Bill Clinton on the path to 9/11. It's shocking that Bill Clinton would ask. You can't imagine Walter Mondale doing that. I don't even think you could imagine Jimmy Carter doing that.
President Clinton has said he never got that close to getting Osama bin Laden. But national security experts have said on the record that the path to 9/11 was accurate.
The path to 9/11 got it right. That's why they were upset. We exposed the hot button truth that they've been trying to bury for years.
The $40 million project was a rating smash with nearly 28 million viewers. It later received 7 Emmy nominations. But if you want to catch The Path to 9/11 on DVD, you can't. ABC Disney won't release it. Why would they pass up millions of dollars in DVD revenue?
I think the initial attacks were really about President Clinton's legacy. However, now, a year later, with the DVD being suppressed, I think it has become about Hillary's run for the White House. All I can say is what the exec at ABC told me, which is if Hillary wasn't running, this wouldn't be a problem.
Hi, Mr. Berger, how are you doing?
Hello, everybody. I have just a brief statement.
last year when I was in the archives reviewing documents, I made an honest mistake. It is one that I deeply regret.
Former Clinton National Security Advisor Sandy Berger pled guilty to stealing and destroying highly classified documents from the National Archives and lying to investigators.
I was surprised and astonished when I learned that he had taken documents out of the National Archives, stuffed them in his socks. I have written that the only reason Berger might have done this was at the behest of Bill Clinton or someone of similar stature who wanted information or, you know, single copies of unique copies removed from the archives.
The papers reportedly revealed Clinton's response regarding the Millennium Bomb plot and Sudan's offer to turn over bin Laden in 1996. But because Sandy Berger destroyed these critical secret documents, the American people may never know the truth about these events or the Clinton administration and 9/11. Sandy Berger was fined, lost his security clearance for 3 years, and was disgraced, especially in Washington. But reportedly, Berger is now an advisor to the presidential campaign of Hillary Rodham Clinton.
It's either that he's really good at foreign policy, which I doubt, or he knows something, or they owe him. And I think that's what it is.
Do I think he should be advising Hillary Clinton? I think he's a perfect candidate to advise Hillary Clinton. He's sleazy. He broke the law. He will do her bidding. He should be her chief of staff, as a matter of fact.
I believe they are criminally guilty of distorting history.
There was a smoking gun in there in terms of what the Clinton administration knew about bin Laden.
Sandy Berger had a mission. That mission was to go in and clean up history, clean up mistakes, destroy any evidence of error or culpability to actions that led to 9/11. He accomplished that. He basically paved the way for her to move forward and give Bill a free pass.
We went through all the speeches that were posted on her website, some 200 of them, and there's no speech that's about counterterrorism or talks about the threat to the homeland.
Whatever Mrs. Clinton took away from the 9/11 experience is now slipping away. Or perhaps she never meant it in the first place. But as far as I know, Senator Clinton simply has not wanted to discuss with clarity and certainly with the kind of authority you would expect from a now senior member of the Senate Armed Services Committee, that we are at war with a totalitarian ideology.
They're throwing everything they can against Trump. False flags, race riots, you name it. George Soros is turning up the heat. The Ford Foundation just gave $100 million to Black Lives Matter. This is the time for vigilance. This is the time to be focused. This is the time to be praying that this republic be restored. But with Hillary, we see this sickening bloodlust, this bloodthirst, where she brags about creating a failed state in Libya and coming and seeing and Gaddafi dying and then organizing al-Qaeda to then become ISIS and invade Syria and target Christians and then not let them get out of the country, but bring the actual Sunni invaders into the United States.
Hillary says we should elect her president because of her tremendous accomplishments in the United States Senate. Well, she's passed roughly 20 bills. Let me tell you what some of them were. To commemorate the 225th anniversary of the American Revolution. To express our appreciation to Alexander Hamilton. To name the Thurgood Marshall Courthouse in Lower Manhattan. To honor the men's and the women's lacrosse high school team from Syracuse High School. To express the sense of Congress that Harriet Tubman, who died over 100 years ago, should have received a federal pension. But is that the legislative gravitas and qualifications on which to elect a president of the United States? Is she kidding?
She's not accountable. She'll never be accountable personally for anything that she does. And her personality is such that she believes that the end justifies the means, no matter what those means are.
What is there that she has accomplished in her life that would lead you to believe that she should become the most powerful person in the country?
Which candidate is most likely to be able to be successful in protecting us from the threat from radical Islam? That is the central crisis of our time.
if she reverts to form, Hillary Clinton will likely be in the future what she has been in the past, which is a person, a woman, a politician of the left. And I don't think that's going to be good for the security of the United States.
I can't imagine that Americans want to go back to the 90s and the country being dragged into this ugly, dysfunctional family drama.
American people deserve to know that their presidency is not for sale, the Lincoln bedroom is not for rent, and lobbyist money can no longer influence policy in the House or the Senate. The problem with nostalgia is what we tend to do is you only remember what you like. And you're right. And you forget the parts that you didn't like.
So what John Edwards is saying about outmoded thinking and nostalgia, I think a dangerous trend to electing people because of how much recognition they have rather than their intrinsic quality.
Liberty. Do you believe in liberty or don't you? Economic liberty, free speech, protecting our borders, protecting our country from terrorism. The issue is liberty.
I think that we're at a very critical time in this country that requires leadership. And I can tell you, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that Hillary Clinton, I know, is not equipped, not qualified to be our commander-in-chief.
Remember the September 7th commander-in-chief forum where Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton appeared separately but back-to-back for 30 minutes each? According to an email forwarded to us late last night and originated from a Comcast email address, the technical crew for NBC, which produced the event, is now speaking out about what took place moments after Clinton walked off the set, a massive profanity-laced tirade aimed at NBC's host, Matt Lauer. It turned out that Clinton had been fed all the questions for approval in advance of the forum. But then, after the approval process, Matt Lauer had a change of heart and decided he would start his questioning with an unapproved line concerning Clinton's use of an illegal private server for her sometimes classified work-related emails.
Let me ask you something ahead of time that I'll ask Mr. Trump in a half an hour. To the best of your ability tonight, can we talk about your qualities and your qualifications to be commander-in-chief and not use this as an opportunity to attack Mr. Trump, all right? And I'll ask him the exact same thing.
I think that's an exactly right way to proceed.
Okay.
This is a very important decision for our country, and each of us should be presenting our experience, our expertise, and our plans to protect and defend the United States and our allies around the world.
What is the most important characteristic that a commander-in-chief can possess?
Steadiness, an absolute rock steadiness, and mixed with strength, to be able to make the hard decisions, because I've had the unique experience of watching and working with several presidents.
So judgment is a key.
Temperament and judgment, yes.
The word judgment has been used a lot around you, Secretary mm-hmm. Clinton, over the last year and a half, and in particular concerning your use of your personal email mm-hmm. and server to communicate while you were Secretary of State. You've said it's a mistake. Mm-hmm. You said you made not the best choice. Mm-hmm. You were communicating on highly sensitive topics. Why wasn't it more than a mistake? Why wasn't it disqualifying if you want to be commander-in-chief?
Well, Matt, first of all, as I have said repeatedly, it was a mistake to have a personal account. I would certainly not do it again. I make no excuses for it. It was something that should not have been done. But the real question is the handling of classified material, which is, I think, what the implication of your question was. And for all the viewers watching you tonight, I have a lot of experience dealing with classified material, starting when I was on the Senate Armed Services Committee, going into the 4 years as Secretary of State. Classified material has a header which says top secret, secret, confidential. Nothing. And I will repeat this, and this is verified in the report by the Department of Justice. None of the emails sent or received by me had such a header.
There are 795 emails in this pile. We've counted them. There are 67 emails in this pile.
Her defense?
they weren't marked classified, they couldn't be marked classified. Because by not using government servers, she actually prevented the government from reviewing her emails. It is a federal crime to negligently handle classified information under 18 U.S.C. 1924.
Now, having said all this, why aren't I 50 points ahead?
Here's your problem. Someone set this thing to evil.
I do recognize that I come into this event with a little bit of an advantage. I know that so many of you in the Archdiocese already have a place in your heart for a guy who started out as a carpenter working for his father. I was a carpenter working for my father. True. Not for a long period of time, but I was for about 3 weeks. What's great about the Al Smith dinner is that even in the rough and tumble world of a really, really hard-fought campaign. In fact, I don't know if you know Hillary, but last night they said that was the most vicious debate in the history of politics, presidential debate, the most vicious. And I don't know, are we supposed to be proud of that or are we supposed to be unhappy? But they did say that, and I'm trying to think back to Lincoln. I don't think they can really compete with that. But the candidates have some lighthearted moments together, which is true. I have no doubt that Hillary is going to laugh quite a bit tonight, sometimes even at an appropriate moment.
Keep talking, you handle it, we're not going anywhere.
Okay, here we are.
Keep talking, man, keep talking.
Okay, we'll keep talking.
And even tonight, with all of the heated back and forth between my opponent and me at the debate last night, we have proven that we can actually be civil to each other. In fact, just before taking the dais, Hillary accidentally bumped into me, and she very civilly said, "Pardon me." And I very politely replied, "Let me talk to you about that after I get into office."
More debates, no more naps.
Will you accept the results of the election?
You know, it was horrifying what he said on the debate stage tonight. You know, our country's been around for 240 years, and, you know, we are a country based on laws.
There's a Russian agent, Podesta, behind her. Look at this. Can't make this up.
We've had hot, contested elections going back to the very beginning, but one of our hallmarks has always been that we accept the outcomes of our elections. We do the best we can to have and fair elections, which we do. And somebody wins and somebody loses.
How did you feel when he said, you know, nasty woman, and you're a puppet, and the issue of Vladimir Putin?
I just didn't pay any attention to that. I was very concerned that even now, after 17 intelligence agencies in our government, both military and civilian, have confirmed that Russia has engaged in cyber attacks against Americans, which is a blatant effort to try to interfere in our elections.
So the elections are totally safe when it comes to Democrats stealing, but Trump's with Putin. Now, Andrea Mitchell, right there from that angle, you can't see it, but a minute before, one of Hillary's campaign people hands her the phone with what the question is they want, which we have the emails and WikiLeaks behind the scenes. This goes on. They roll oranges at her, and you know, it's all scripted. And a lot of times she's reading a teleprompter, even during an interview with the interviewer in person. So it's all basically a theater. But we've caught it on video. DrudgeReport.com is linked. to the Infowars.com video and article about it. Obviously, radio listeners can't see this, but I'll describe it for you. Let's go ahead and roll that video. Of
the whole time, no more debates, no more naps. Will you accept the
What do you, Secretary Clinton,
feel,
Secretary,
how do you feel when he said, you know, nasty woman, and you're a puppet, and
the issue of Vladimir Putin?
Yeah, I just didn't pay any attention.
Yeah, it's the press secretary handing the phone to Mitchell to ask the next question, nasty woman. They want to get that nasty woman thing out. So you literally have Hillary's people directing CNN in front of everyone.
To try to interfere in our elections.
Nasty.
And he's saying, I've got a question. You know, signaling, just like in the first debate, she was signaling. There they are signaling. Incredible.
Director Comey also said this after reviewing all the information. He said there is evidence to support a conclusion that any reasonable person in Secretary Clinton's position should have known that an unclassified system was no place for that conversation.
Well, Matt, I just respectfully point.
According to a Comcast official, the parent company of NBC Universal, who apparently was quoting those on the set, when Matt posed the one legitimate question about the FBI investigation concerning her homemade server and the unsecured emails, we could see she was beginning to boil. According to an NBC associate producer of the forum, as soon as Clinton got off the set, she exploded. Hillary proceeded to pick up a full glass of water and throw it at the face of her assistant, and then the screaming started. She was in a full meltdown, and no one on her staff dared speak with her. She went kind of manic and did not have control over herself at that point. How these people work with this woman is amazing to me. She really didn't seem to care who heard any of it. You really had to see this to believe it. She came apart, literally unglued. She is the most foul-mouthed woman I've ever heard, and that voice at screech level, awful. She screamed she'd get that effing Lauer fired for this. Referring to Donald Trump, Clinton said, if that effing bastard wins, we all hang from nooses. Lauer's finished, and if I lose, it's all on your heads for screwing this up. So crooked Hillary fears the gallows, eh? Her dozen or more aides were visibly disturbed and tried to calm her down when she started shaking uncontrollably as she screamed to get an executive at Comcast, the parent company of NBC Universal, on the phone. Then two rather large aides grabbed her and helped her walk to her car. Matt Lauer was massively criticized for the rest of the week on air by the Clinton campaign and the rest of the MSM as having conducted an unfair and partisan attack on Clinton. According to the email, calls were made to the New York Times, the Washington Post, Huffington Post, and Twitter executives with orders to crush Matt Lauer. One staffer on the Clinton campaign told the NBC staff that they all fear Clinton's wrath and uncontrollable outbursts, and one described Hillary as an egotistical psychopath. Since Hillary does not allow any staff to have cell phones when she is in their presence, no footage is available. Interim DNC chairman Donna Brazile, the first black woman to hold the position, was singled out by Hillary during the rant. She screamed at Donna, I'm so sick of your face. You stare at the wall like a brain-dead buffalo while letting that effing Lauer get away with this. What are you good for, really? Get to work. Janitoring this mess. Do I make myself clear? A female NBC executive said that Donna Brazile looked at Mrs. Clinton and never flinched, which seemed to enrage Hillary all the more. The executive continued, it was the most awful and terrible and racist display, such a profane meltdown I've ever witnessed from anyone, and I will never forget it. That woman should never see the inside of the Oval Office, I can tell you that. She was unhinged and just continued to verbally abuse everyone. She was out of control. Why did Lauer ask his rogue question? According to sources close to Lauer, because the American people deserve an answer from the former Secretary of State.
But on specific issues, I've come out with very specific plans. With respect to Social Security, I do have a plan.
But personally, I am not going to be advocating any specific fix until I am seriously approaching fiscal responsibility.
Do you, the New York Senator Hillary Clinton, support the New York governor's plan to give illegal immigrants a driver's license?
I did not say that it should be done, but I certainly recognize why Governor Spitzer is trying to do it.
No. You said yes.
No.
You thought it made sense to do it.
No, I didn't, Chris. It makes a lot of sense. What is the governor supposed to do? Do I think this is the best thing for any governor to do? No.
Obviously, she hadn't been coached on. And if she's not coached, she's, despite the fact that she's intelligent, she is so insecure and so loathes the give and take of real politics that she just seizes up. And she sure seized up when those questions were asked her.
Now, finally, for the first time, everyone talks about, well, Hillary talks about how, oh, they were so mean to her. All that happened in that debate was that, I think it was Tim Russert in that debate, engaged in the old journalistic practice of the follow-up question. That's all it took. And, you know, all hell breaks loose because Hillary's asked to actually tell us what your position is.
What is the most important characteristic that a commander-in-chief can possess?
Steadiness. An absolute rock steadiness. Protest Trump because Trump and his kids have killed a lot of animals.
They had their entire lives ahead of them.
What is the most important characteristic that a commander-in-chief can possess?
Steadiness. An absolute rock steadiness.
Trying to cover up her collapse in New York on 9/11. Before we celebrate that, you have to understand, the crime syndicate behind Hillary isn't going to give up power easily.
Anarchists are flooding in. And they're taking over these protests and turning it into riots, where they're destroying stores, where they're destroying cars.
President Obama met with Donald Trump the other day, and he put on a good face, but it was a two-faced. Is that really, as Kellyanne Conway said, he could quiet this down, he could tell people to be quiet. But in fact, this morning, he was complimenting the protesters, saying they had a right to protest. So. Don't be fooled by this facade in the White House right now. President Obama, I believe, and his co-conspirators at Black Lives Matter, Al Sharpton, Louis Farrakhan, Nation of Islam, they want to see this erupt because they're not satisfied with the election results. And in fact, they've stoked a potential civil war here.
Listen, these are the same rioters that were involved in Black Lives Matter. These are all paid agitators. This is nothing new. This is the same thing that they've done. The 1969 riots in Berkeley, this same exact thing. These are all paid agitators. It's the same group of individuals. You had a lot of rioters out there that are protesting and don't even know what they're protesting about. And that just kind of feeds to the further narrative that when Hillary Clinton lost the election, that they were going to do everything they can to destroy Donald Trump. And so you can see that. I mean, this is all funded by George Soros.
I mean, how responsible is President Obama for these riots?
I think he's very, very responsible for it. This is all his agenda. He set this whole thing in motion.
I just have to remind people of the track record. If you want someone with a lifelong track record. So now this is Senator Clinton. This is the same person who has taken more money from lobbyists than any other candidate, Democratic or Republican, of fighting for higher wages and better benefits and a fairer tax code and a bigger voice for workers and stronger regulations on Wall Street. This is the same person who took money from financial folks on Wall Street and then voted for a bankruptcy bill that makes it harder for folks right here in Pennsylvania to get a fair shake. Then you should vote for Hillary Clinton. This is the same person who spent a decade with her husband campaigning for NAFTA and now goes around saying how she was opposed to NAFTA. She's got specific ideas to invest in new jobs, to help workers share in their company's profits. This is the same person who says she's voting for the Columbia trade deal. Turns out that her top advisor, her top strategist, was working for the Colombian government to get the bill passed. There has never been a man or a woman, not me, not Bill, nobody, more qualified than Hillary Clinton to serve as president of the United States of America.
Ooh, isn't that amazing? Ooh, it's a woman. She can walk and talk.
It all comes down to you now. It all comes down to you now.
What the fuck was that? I know, right?
We must never underestimate this woman. We must never understate her chances of winning. We mustn't be lulled into a state of security and complacency. And we must never forget the fundamental danger that this woman poses to every value that we hold dear.
If you think Barack Obama is a corrupt president, you ain't seen nothing yet. Hillary Clinton will make Barack Obama look like a choir boy. And unlike Barack Obama, Hillary Clinton has been around the block a few times and has the keys to all the secret doors in Washington. Most notably, the door that leads to a massive electronic file on every single American. Be afraid, America. Be very afraid.
The truth is, Hillary Clinton wants to mount America's head on the wall. Hillary Clinton wants to dominate this republic. Hillary Clinton is an enemy, a domestic enemy, and an agent of globalism. And if this republic is to survive, Hillary Clinton must fall. The good news is, Providence has always shown that when the people take action, do the right thing, and take those first steps, God will carry us historically the rest of the way. And the hand of doom, as we see her deteriorate on a daily basis, has already reached Hillary Rodham Clinton.
Almost every one of the investigations we did for 8 years where there were problems, and I mean major problems with the Clinton administration, she was at the core of them.
It's part of the Clinton method, which is say what you need to say at any given moment and rely on the lack of memory of the American public and the support of the mainstream media to support that lack.
You know, a lot of people ask me, do we have to go through all these old Clinton scandals again? Well, I have good news for you. You don't, because you can look at the new ones, because Hillary Clinton scandals are a gift that keeps on giving.
Ruthless, vindictive,
mendacious, venal, sneaky,
intolerant,
liar is a good one.
Scares the hell out of me.
Looks good in a pantsuit.
I'm Donald Trump, and I approve this message.